Okay.
I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. It never was a sweeter melody. 'Tis a melody of love.
In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody of love. I love the Christ who died on Calvary, for he washed my sins away.
Number 60, Jesus is coming again. Amen. And on the last stanza, number 4, I want you all to sing with us. Okay?
Amen.
Okay.
Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Now, what language is that?
Some African language.
Okay.
Some African language.
Big hello, that's what it means.
Feliz Sabbath. That is my language. Papiamento. Feliz Sabbath.
Okay. Feliz
Sabbath. And Spanish it is Feliz Sábado. Feliz Sábado. And in Dutch, they say gezegende Sabbath. Gezegende Sabbath.
They have a different language. Could you say yours again?
Malam, malam selegum. That's African dialect.
Okay.
How are you?
Okay, good, 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 good.
I don't know how to say Sabbath yet.
Okay, that's good. And if there are some German people who are listening, or we will say Guten Morgen. Gut geschlafen? Ein wenigstens einen guten Tag. Jesu ist Liebe. Es ist gesegnete Sabbat, and that God is love. That is German.
All the languages in Sabbath. So,
and we don't have to forget in Brazil, and that is Bom dia, Bom Sabbat. Mm-hmm. Sábado, or Sábado. That is Portuguese. I'm happy in this Sabbath morning to be here once more again in the United States. Thank you for your hospitality. I'm so great so that I can talk with a lot of brothers and sisters who come from different parts of the United States, and keep hearing testimonies, especially when we have dinner. I learn a lot because I hear everybody giving some testimony what is going around where they come from. And that is a blessing. And then we go back home, I will share.
Where are you from?
I'm from Curacao, sorry.
Curacao?
Yes, Curacao. Curacao is just in the Caribbean.
Yeah.
It is on the north coast of Venezuela.
Oh.
Just maybe 25, 30 kilometers from the coast of Venezuela.
Okay.
And where I live in Curacao, when we have good weather, we can see the hills and the mountains of Venezuela.
Venezuela.
So, Caracas. Caracas, yeah.
Yeah,
it's the capital, Caracas, yes. So there is where I came from. Mm-hmm. And back home, we speak Papiamento. And we were Dutch colonies. Mm-hmm. And we have a Dutch education. And we have to learn at school in Dutch. And the Dutch education that we have, you have to learn English and Spanish. And some years ago, German and French. But now you can choose if you like to study German and French. But my mother, she learned at that time, and she could speak fluent German, French, English, and more than six or seven languages. And that is a blessing because in Curacao, it is just a little island, but there is a lot of tourists coming from US, from Europe, from all part of the world. And it is like
you're in Central Station.
Pardon? Pardon? Okay, so it is just like a good center how the gospel can be spread to all the world, like Capernaum and some of these places. So. And it is a blessing that we can communicate with different people from different places and speak their languages so that we can be able to share Jesus Christ with those people who come for vacation. So, to enter in the world, we will kneel down for a word of prayer.
Yes.
So, ask God blessing. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Sabbath day. We thank you, Lord, for a new day, for life, for health, for strength. We pray that your Holy Spirit, Father, will be poured upon each one of us in this morning as we study your word, as we pray, and as we meditate and ask thee for wisdom, knowledge, courage, zeal to do your work. We are sure that you will answer our prayer and fill us with your Holy Spirit in this morning to do the work that has to be done. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. How many of you heard the sound of the horn in this morning?
I did.
I was way up on the mountains there, and I blow on the trumpet. You know? And, you know, amid these mountains, you know, if you hear, you can hear, you know, the sounds go and go and go and keep going.
Mm-hmm.
So, and in this morning, I'm not gonna blow on this because maybe it will hurt your ear.
What is that you call that?
There's a horn of a shofar.
Oh, Okay.
Yeah, Pastor Allen always call it shofar. It's shofar.
Give us a two. Give us a two now. That's the idea, two.
Okay. Then just as
well,
you...
You're going to blow on the other end of it.
If you see, here is a...
Oh, yeah, you have the hole.
Yeah, you have a hole here. I noticed when we were in Peru, they make a hole right here.
Yeah.
And then they blow, but it gives a different sound.
Different tune.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and so I used to play on my sax. Mm-hmm. And then when you play on a sax, you don't have to put much air. But don't and this is the same thing. And in this morning, you can imagine, I was just sharing with where is Zach? Zach is here, a little ones. I teach him in 5 minutes how to blow on the horn, and some from adults. You know, we have been helping people for months to blow, and just in 5 minutes, Zach was blowing. And I just asked him to come here in this morning to just blow. But I'm just going to blow on it so that you can hear. You can blow very hard.
It's a good sound.
It's a good sound. Yeah. And do you know the horn, back in Curacao after slavery, they used this horn as their communication system. Today we have different electronic devices that we use, like computer, telephone, iPhones, and all these things. But this was the communication that they used back in the time back when there was slavery. And those people who are living, like my grandmother, my grandfather, they can listen when someone blow on the horn and tell you what is the message. And you know, also when they have harvest, they invite all neighbors to come and they're gonna harvest, they're gonna cut the corn. But it is not just everyone come in on the field and cut harvest. No, one go before and he give certain sound with the horn. And then people will know which side they have to cut the corn. And so in a record time, they will harvest great field of corn. And this is very important. But today, most of the young people, they even know about a horn. They don't recognize anymore the sound and to tell you what that sound means. They cannot recognize anymore. And but what about the horn? What is it? What is this thing? If we just take in our hand 3D, just take it. What is it?
Dust.
Where did it come from?
From an animal.
From an animal. Okay. From a cow. Yes, sure. And this is a cow from Mexico. Someone who just visited Mexico, just bring this for me, and it's from Mexico. But did the Bible talk about horn?
Yes.
Trumpets.
Give a certain sound. Yeah, for a certain sound, yeah. And what does the Bible say about horn? Maybe we can dig holes with it, or what?
It can come up and uproot people to a horn.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Little horn.
Little horn. Yeah, little horn.
It's the animal's instrument to protect them and to fight with also.
Yes.
So it's a...
Sure. That's, yes. And so, then animal can kill you with a horn. That's very dangerous.
For you.
Sure. And...
My grandfather was killed by a bull.
Yeah? Okay. We see how dangerous a horn can be.
But Elvis, there's horns on the altar too, right? In the
sanctuary. Oh yes. But in this morning, we're gonna have something serious to talk about the horn. How many of us here have been in the Supreme Court? Sister Elaine, you are a lawyer. You have been there?
You talking about the major one?
Yeah.
No, not the major one.
Major one. Okay. So, well, I never have been there before. Never. But I have a good friend who always tells me some good things, and that is Pastor Allen. And you know, he says, in the Supreme Court, those who go into the Supreme Court have to be sure that there is silence. No coughing, no sneezing. Silence. On this Sabbath day, on this Sabbath morning, in our Sabbath school, this is more important than the Supreme Court. Because God has a special message for each one of us this morning. The song that Brother Mike picked up in this morning, the song 71. I'm going to share a little testimony with you about this song. We have been working in South America, in Brazil, in Chile, Venezuela, Colombia, visiting our brothers and sisters that just came out of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. They didn't believe in the Trinity anymore. But still, there is a lot of confusion in those groups who are coming out. And I was praying, Lord, help me how we can help our brothers and sisters to know Jesus Christ better. And then in one night, I was sleeping. And the Lord tell me, and you know, I have different experience that God just tell me by my name and tell me, Elvis, do this. By my name, I can hear God come, Elvis, do this. You know, I share one experience with you. 2 years ago, I was working way back down in Uruguay. And there I don't have a telephone to communicate with my family back in Curacao. No computer, nothing. And one Sabbath, Sabbath afternoon, we had a community meeting in the village close where I was staying. And when I go back home, that night I couldn't sleep. And I was praying. And then God tell me, Elvis, they gonna shoot your cousin. He is the prime minister in my country. And then when I wake up, I keep praying, and then I could call back to Curacao, I could call my wife because there is no communication. And then that Sunday night I was giving Bible study and I received a call. And my wife tell me, you know, something happened here. They just shoot your cousin. And she told me, but they don't know if he is alive or he is dead. And I told my wife, you know, God tell me yesterday night that he will die. And some hours late, my wife called me and tell me he died. Way back from Curacao, I was all the way down there in Uruguay. And I was thinking about that. Why God tell me this? Should I could do something to help them not to kill him? And I was keeping thinking about that. But I come to understand that God has just telling me that he know that I was working down in Uruguay. And that I can trust him for all what I need, and that I can trust him that he will take care of my family when I was working out in the field. And God knows each one of us. He can call us by our name. He know where we live. He know everything. And in the beginning of this year, praying, and one night, God tell me this, Elvis, go and tell my people that they make sure that they have their real high priest. Mm-hmm. And we're going to talk about this. Be sure, make sure that you have your real high priest, that is Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. And we're going to open our Bible in this morning in the book of Matthew. In the book of Matthew 24, this is our Sabbath school in this morning. Matthew 24, we will read verse 3 and 4, and then move to verse 15. Matthew 24, verse 3 and 4 says, "And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, Tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of the coming and of the end of the world?" And Jesus continued in verse 4. "And Jesus answered and said unto them, Take heed that no man deceive you." And then we move to verse 15. It says, "When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken by Daniel the prophet stand in the holy place, whoso readeth, let him understand." So my question here is, where is Jesus leading us? What book Jesus is telling us to study? Daniel, the book of Daniel. Well, in the Bible, if we study the Bible, we see many horns. We read about many horns. But there is two horns in the Bibles that we have to be sure that we are under the power of this horn or the other horn. And we will look in the Bible, this one horn on this side and the other horn on that side. Because there is two characteristics in these two horns. And we have to be sure that we can separate them one from another. To be sure that. Okay, we're going to move now to Luke. Let me go to the book of Luke, chapter 1, 69, verse 69. Here we're going to see another horn. There's two horns that we're going to deal with this in this morning. Luke chapter 1, verse 69. And we read also verse 68. Are we ready? Okay. "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people." Verse 69 now. "And hath raised up a horn." He hath raised up a horn. A horn of? Salvation for us in the house of his servant David. Who is this horn? Jesus Christ. We have to make sure that we know Jesus Christ, the horn of salvation. Because there is here on earth no other name that we can be saved. Only in the name and the power of the horn of the house of David. But there is another horn of another house. Let's go and see where this power, the horn, is. Therefore, Jesus says, go and study the book of Daniel. With other words, go into the sanctuary. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and life. And where can we find the way? Psalm 77, verse 13. It is a sanctuary. So then we will move into the sanctuary and to see. We will move to Daniel, because Daniel gave us a lot of information about the sanctuary. Where can we find this other horn in the book of Daniel? Let's move to Daniel. We will read to chapter 8. Okay, 7 and 8. But we will go into 8 and we will read verse 9 to 11. Daniel chapter 8, verse 9 to 11. We all get there? Okay, we have it? Here we go. Therefore, the he-goat waxed very great, and when he was strong, the great horn was broken, and for it came up four notable ones toward the four winds of heaven. Verse 9. And out of one of them came forth a little horn, which waxed exceeding great toward the south, and toward east, and toward the pleasant land. Who is this horn? Can we identify who is this horn? Mm-hmm. And where is the first place that they moved to? To the south. Uh-huh. What did he get there to the south? Where did he move to the south? If the Bible says we move to the south, the little one moved to the south. Where did he move to? Egypt. And where is the, what did he found in Egypt? Paganism.
Theopolis.
Oh yes. During this camp meeting, we have learned a lot during this week about how to prepare for the end. Many very good studies we have done. And some brothers was pointed out that we are not point fingers at anybody. But in this morning, we're going to do something different. First Isaiah 58 verse 1, tell us what? Blow on the trumpet. Blow on the horn and tell people what? And I remember one of the studies that Sister Annika did also. And Sister Annika put a picture on the screen, and that was very interesting. I saw a man who was preaching, you know, and he was pointed out not with his finger but with his body. You know, there is something very important in this study that we have to really pray to God that will help us to understand. We are not pointing fingers or our whole body to the Seventh-day Adventist Church. We are not doing that. I am not pointing finger to someone particular.
Right.
Listen very good. But I am pointing my finger and my whole body and all that I can use to point to the man of sin who is destroying not only the Seventh-day Adventist Church, but the whole world. Yeah. Because what the little horn did in history, in the past, what he is doing now, and what he is going to do in the future is to take from the Christian world, to take from the Seventh-day Adventist Church, to take from you and I personally, mm-hmm. our high priest, our real high priest, and give us another priest mm-hmm. who cannot pardon sin and not cleanse us of our sins.
That's right. Amen.
You can have all the knowledge that you have about the sanctuary. Mm-hmm. You can have all the knowledge that you have about health, mm-hmm. about all the science. But if you have the wrong high priest, mm-hmm. the wrong high priest cannot pardon our sin.
Amen.
He cannot cleanse us from our sin.
Mm-hmm.
It is only Jesus Christ.
Yes, sir.
And no matter about your past, your history, you can do nothing with that. We started CBT therapy. Activated event, beliefs, and consequences. You can do nothing with events that already happened. You can change your history. You can cleanse yourself from your sins. But what you can do to correct your belief, and then Jesus, who is our high priest, can cleanse us from all our sins. Amen. And then the consequences that will follow. We have peace, we have joy, we have long suffering, because this is the fruit of the Spirit. But only Jesus can do this. Only Jesus. If you never have been under the influence of the little horn, if you never have been under the influence, under his teachings, it is not easy for you, or it is easy for you to understand the fundamental doctrine of the little horn. But once you were under the influence of the little horn, then it is difficult to understand who Jesus, your high priest, really is. Amen. And that's what the little horn did. He cast down what?
Truth.
The truth. He threw down truth. You can go into Daniel. And he stamped up there. Yeah, you heard people talk about the daily? The daily? Many people don't know what is the dailies. Many Seventh-day Adventists today don't know what is daily. But what is the daily?
Paganism.
Mm-hmm. And if you will go into the Hebrew word for daily, that is tamid, and it means also a daily ministry. Something that is going on daily. Daily. And we have the real service of the sanctuary.
Amen.
The only way for us to know and understand the real service of the sanctuary is to know our high priest.
Amen.
You know, I live back there in Curacao, just a little island. But the little horn has put his sanctuary down there. Everywhere, Bible says, everywhere he went, he put his sanctuary. And he put his priest. And most Christians today in our Christian world don't know that the service of the Catholic Church is the most dangerous service. If you go into Great Controversy, you will see that. Their music, their temples, their sanctuaries. It worked on the people's mind to make people reverence. And this is very dangerous. Our biggest enemy is the little horn. Paul spent three Sabbaths. Let me go to Acts chapter 17. Acts chapter 17. We read verse 1 to 3. Acts 17. Paul, a man who worked hard for the Lord, tells us that he was in Thessalonica, and 3 days, three Sabbaths, he spent with the brothers and sisters there, trying to reason with them. Verse 1 to 3, it says, "Now, when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where was the synagogue of the Jews. And Paul, as his manner was, went in into them, and three Sabbath days reasoning with them out of the scriptures, opening and the legend that Christ must need have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus whom I preach unto you is Christ. This Jesus that I preach unto you is our high priest. The anointed one. And if we go to the second book of Thessalonica, Thessalonica, we will find Paul here, and we will see the parallel here with Paul's writings and the book of Daniel. Because Paul also studied the book of Daniel. Paul knew about the sanctuary. And this is the sanctuary, is the center pillar of the seven pillars of the Seventh-day Adventist doctrine. Amen. And if the center pillar will be thrown down and trapped in it, how can we be safe? Yeah. And here Paul spent three Sabbaths trying to help the people there. And he, we start with verse 1, 2 Thessalonica. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by all our gathering together into him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by the word, nor by letter, as for from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand, in Paul's days, back in the first century. Because Paul studied the book of Daniel. He knew that the man of sin was coming. And in verse 3 it says, let no man deceive you by any means. For that day shall not come except there come a falling away first. And that man of sin, Paul was pointing the brothers and sisters here to the man of sin. Amen. What he is doing. And my brothers and sisters, we heard on the news, on paper, a lot about the little horn that's going to visit U.S. this year in September. We heard about the economy will crash. We heard about a lot of things that will happen when the little horn moves to USA. A lot of things will happen because Spirit of Prophecy tells us clear that when United States just give hand with the papacy, what will happen? Ruin. Ruin.
Tribulation of our country.
So my brothers and sisters, it is time for us to blow on the horn and tell our brothers and sisters here in the U.S. and everywhere on this earth.
Amen.
Be aware, because the little horn is coming.
Yes.
Don't be afraid that you will lose your job, or the economy will crash, or there will come earthquake or famine. You can name it. But be sure, as Paul is telling the brothers and sisters here, that no man deceive you. Paul is pointing them here to the man of sin. And who is this man of sin?
The little horn.
The little horn. And who is the little horn today? Should we have the courage to go to the Congress and raise up this horn and tell, this man is the little horn?
We should.
We should. Mac, are you ready to go?
I'm ready.
It will have consequences.
Yeah.
But the life of one sinner is more precious for Jesus than everything else on this world. So we have to make sure that we lift up Jesus before our people. That they can have the real high priest and don't accept this little horn message. Because the little horn is coming down to do what? Throw the two down and? And Jesus Christ is the truth. And I will share with you what one of those people of the same system of the little horn says about the little horn. So we can see that our Bible is correct when he tell us who the little horn is. That we can warn our people that what the little horn is coming to do is to destroy, not physically, but our spiritual life. To tell us and to give us another high priest who is not Jesus. And that this conclusion and statement as to what the papal system really is not extravagant nor far-fetched. It's confirmed by the words of the Cardinal Baronius, the standard analyst of the papacy. And hear what he is saying. Writing of the 10th century, he says, in this century, the abomination of desolation was seen in the temple of the Lord and in the see of St. Peter, reverenced by angels, where placed the most wicked men, not pontiffs, but monsters, and the Council of Rome in 991 declare the papacy to be the man of sin, the mystery of iniquity. So, this man is coming to the United States not to do any good, but to destroy the nation. And our only safeguard is Jesus Christ. And as we continue studying the sanctuary, my time is running up. But if we study the sanctuary, we can see how the little horn just destroyed the sanctuary message that God had for his people. Daniel 8:14, it says, into 2,300 days, and the sanctuary will be purified. Now, the responsibility of you and I is to work to purify the sanctuary. And how can we do this? This is the three angel messages. And the right hand of the three angel messages is what? The health work. And therefore, Isaiah 58 says in verse 1, blow the trumpet. My brothers and sisters, it is high time for us to wake up.
Amen. Amen.
Those who are asleep, wake up.
Yeah.
It's not time to sleep. And in the book of Hebrews, Paul knows his sanctuary very, very good. We should also know the sanctuary, because if we don't know our sanctuary, we could be sure that we don't have the real high priest. If you don't know the sanctuary message, it is very important. Study the book of Daniel and the Revelation in these last days. Because it is important for us to know the sanctuary message. And Paul says in Hebrews chapter 8, verse 1 and 2, now of this which we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such a high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle, which the Lord pitched, and not man, not the little horn. If you know the history of McCoy and the time of, they just start with the switch off train and this thing, you know, just to lubricate this thing. Every time they have to stop the train and put some oil for lubrication. Then McCoy just invented a way that the train can keep going and the oil will lubricate all these parts. And we have the saying in US, the real McCoy. How we could be sure today that we have the real high priest? Because if you don't have the real McCoy, you buy maybe to the advanced auto parts to get some parts for the auto. Maybe you have a Mercedes or you are a Porsche or you have some car, and then you just look for another part that is not real. Well, the owner will tell you, well, this is not a real one. It is cheaper, but it could have consequences. You can burn your home car. We have to be sure that we have the real high priest. If you have forgot everything that we have been preaching during this camp meeting, don't forget this. Be sure, because this is the message. Be sure that my people have the real high priest. Be sure that you are under the power of the horn of salvation of the house of David, not the house of Rome, Italy, or the Roman system. And we have to tell our people, because still, the book Great Controversy tells us that there's a lot of Catholics, a lot of priests in the Catholic Church. They are sincere because they never had the opportunity to look in the Bible. But when we lifted up Jesus before those people, teach them the true sanctuary message, give them the real McCoy, the real high priest, then they will accept it and help us to finish the work. May God bless us as we raise up Jesus Christ, raise up the horn of the house of David, and not the horn that is coming in September. May God bless us to make correct and accurate decisions, because our belief will have consequences. May God bless us as we hold tight to our high priest, that is Jesus Christ, our Savior. May God bless us. Amen. Amen. Shall we kneel down for a word of prayer? Our Heavenly Father, we are so thankful on this Sabbath day. It's a beautiful Sabbath day. It's one of the best Sabbath days that I ever have experienced. And I thank you, Father, in this morning for our real High Priest, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross of Calvary, who shed his blood to cleanse us from all sin. Thank you so much, Father, that we can fix our eyes not on September, not on the little horn, but that our eyes could be fixed in the most holy place in heaven where our high priest is living right now. The work that he is doing, the ministry that he is doing right now for each one of us to pardon our sins, to cleanse us from all our sins, that we can have the peace of Jesus. And whatever will come, with this peace of Jesus, we can go through and see Jesus come on the clouds of heaven and say, this is our Lord we are waiting for, and he will save us. Thank you so much, Father, for your message and for the sanctuary message that point us to the high priest. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Good.
Okay.